Hey friends, we're continuing our ASP.NET Core 101 series. We're going to continue to enhance our web API. So this is part two in the last web API video. We did a GET request to slash products. We got back our products, but we didn't actually modify the data or do anything with the data. In this one, let's actually change it and write it back into our database.
Yeah. So I know one of the things I personally like to do when I'm on Etsy or, you know, Yelp or something, I like to rate things. Something's really bad, no stars or zero stars. So.
Well, we should make sure that our API supports you giving us zero stars.
Yeah.
So what we're going to try to do is make a ratings API that's going to basically go on top of our products service. Okay. Now, of course, this isn't exhaustive. This is not a 300-level web API video series. So in the future, we'll do one of those. But for now, we're just getting a taste of what you can do with web API. So let's do that. Let's also remind ourselves kind of what we were doing.
Yep.
At the very beginning, if you
go
back.
It's been a while.
Yeah, it has. If you go back to the very beginning of all of this, we made a product class. And that's the shape of our product. It has like an image and a URL and title and a description. And we put in ratings, but we never really did anything with it. Yeah.
Maybe we should.
We were thinking about it, though.
Take advantage of that.
So a rating for us is an array of integers. And I think we were thinking like 1 to 10 or 1 to 5 kind of thing.
Cool. 1 to 5 seems pretty good.
Okay. So 1 to 5 ratings, so like 5 stars. And then just a reminder again, our database. This is a real database, by the way. All of these things you'll be able to find up on GitHub. And these are real folks. Jen Looper, SailorHG, Selena, Vogue and Code. Our friend April there, these are real products, so you can go and buy these products and support our friends who gave us these images in their actual Etsy shops. So what we're going to expect to do is have, you know, all this stuff and then ratings at the end.
Yeah, because I'm noticing ratings isn't currently there, so we're probably going to have to write that property in.
That is a great point, because the property's there, but right now it's kind of null or it's just not available. Yep. So if there is no array, we're assuming it has no ratings. So that brings up a good point we'll have to think about. No ratings versus empty array. What does null mean? Will be a good question. So under our JSON file product service right now, if we go and close up the things that don't matter, it basically just does get products. But what we want to do is go and say add ratings. And we can do that in a couple of ways. I'll say public void add rating. Mm-hmm. And this is not the web API part of it. This is the
service
part, right? So this isn't doing any HTTP kind of stuff right now. It's just a function.
And I think in this case, it would make sense to try to retrieve the product by something that's unique to it. So like an ID, typically.
Yep. So we have a product ID. And then let's say that folks are going to pass in, you know, the rating.
Mm-hmm.
And then you said retrieve it. So we'll say, let's go and get our products. And because our service is building on top of ourselves, we can just call ourselves.
Perfect.
Get products. So now we have in products a list of products, and we've been saying var. You're a fan of var.
I prefer my strongly typed.
No,
I'm not gonna lie.
No,
why? Var works too, though. So much better.
Could go and say an explicit type, which would, like, is what you're saying you prefer. I thought you were one of our var people, which is unfortunate. We'll still be friends, though. And then let's go and do a query, and let's go and say, hey products, give me the first. And let's go and get some products, some theoretical product X, rocket ship. And let's say, let's get one where, and I say rocket ship, but people say is the case or goes to, or give me an X where it is, its ID is the product ID.
So it's like we're retrieving the first product that we can find that is equal to the ID that we passed in.
Exactly. Right.
So this is some shorthand, right?
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't have to do with link querying. So that's kind of syntax that's similar to if you were to make a query with like SQL or something else in a database.
That's a great point. This is a SQL-like or a structured query language. You might say SQL if you're doing databases. Link is a thing that we're going to cover actually in C# 200-level video, so you can go and check that out.
Awesome.
With our friends in a little bit. So if you, in fact, have no query at all, or you have no ratings, then that's a thing we talked about. We have nothing. We have no plan. So if they're null, do some stuff.
Yep.
Else, do some other stuff. So what do we do if they're null? We probably need to,
initialize the
make some room. Yeah.
Property. Yep.
So we'll say query.ratings, and then there's different ways that we could probably do this. Maybe we could make our objects smarter and be more explicit about not having a rating, so we could potentially get rid of that.
That's true.
Right. You know, maybe make it so the setter does it for us. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But if you in fact found some ratings. then what should we do? We should...
Let's convert them to a list.
All right, so we'll go and say query.ratings, and that's again an array. Fun thing we can do, just say to list. And now we have a convenient list, and it's a little easier to add stuff to lists, right? So then what's our rating? Our rating coming in is this one here, rating. So we'll go and we'll add that rating.
Again, each of our products has an array of ratings because we're eventually going to take the average of all the user-specified ratings.
Now this is an interesting thing. Notice how I said rating singular here and it complained? Because that's a rating. And I wouldn't try to do it again. Well, you can't have two. That's one and that's another one. I was actually supposed to say ratings. Okay, then we'll take that object and let's just go and put our ratings back over the top of those ratings, okay? And now we made this array a list and it's not letting me put that list back into that array.
Yep. Well, maybe if we convert back to the initial array that we had.
So that's a thing we can do. We can go to array as well. Now, if that's not available, say int doesn't have a to array, I'll do that control, that control dot, or I can go and make sure that that's available as a link query. Okay. I'm going to hit control dot, and hey, I didn't get any help.
Well, I think you used rating instead of ratings.
See? So maybe I should name my variables better. There we go. There you go. Copies that element back to an array. So I went and switched to a list, did my convenience thing, and then switched back.
Awesome.
Okay, cool. So at this point...
So we mentioned before in the JSON file, that ratings property isn't even there currently to begin with.
Right.
And we're going to ultimately need to update that database, this mock database.
But our products does know what ratings are because we've been going and updating that. So we need to go and serialize this. We need to go and put this back into the file. Now this is a little bit more complicated maybe than it needs to be. So forgive me as we do this. But what we're going to basically do is we're going to go and open up that file again. We're going to say dot open write. Now you had commented when we were writing this that maybe we could hide this.
Yeah, something I'd like to do with a function like this, especially serialization or deserialization, which is ultimately going to get used a lot if you're doing this kind of thing, is just create either another method or even a whole new class for this JSON stuff.
Yeah, and I think you're right because when we talk about responsibilities, I think we were deciding that there's a lot going on here, and maybe we have more here than is necessary.
And even if you do understand it, chances are you're going to get tired of writing this over and over again.
Yeah, that's a great point.
Or read something.
So here I'm going to go and take my product, and I'm going to go, and then this is a little bit interesting. There's lots of different ways to go and write out some text, and we don't want to assume that our people are only speaking English.
Yeah.
Right? So I want to make sure that if our languages or maybe Japanese or Chinese or something more complicated, that we can do that. So we do a thing called UTF-8, which is the I can speak any language. So even though our products right now are only in English, we're going to go and make sure our serialization happens in any language. So we've added these little options. And this is an option here that is being added onto this.
Yep.
Probably all of this, the fact that we've gotten this far, should be in another function. So I think you're right. In the future, we'll probably hide some of this. Now notice that there's some little squigglies, so I've probably missed something. I think I did not want to put that there.
Yeah.
And then products. So let's take a look and let Visual Studio do the work. See how if you put your cursor, it will try to figure out where things match up. So here we've got this, and that goes to here, and then products goes to here. And then that one goes to there. So I think I've got one additional daily than more than I need. And this is a real common thing when you're doing any kind of, of programming.
I think I found your problem.
What do you
got
for me?
I used an extra bracket here instead of a parenthesis.
Which one? So where should
the
I
The one at the end of products listed there.
Okay, so I don't need, so that's a bracket.
One.
And then, oh, look at that. Good job.
Go.
Thank you for that.
Yep.
Cool. So that is ripe for being refactored. And if I go and close that up, that's not too scary.
Nope, don't
and then
to see that.
The fact that I can even close that in this collapsing editor is kind of a nice reminder that maybe that should be another function. So I appreciate that. At this point though, we haven't got anything webby here. We've just made a new method on our service.
Yeah, so maybe we should tell something like our controller that we created in the last video to actually call it and ask for that information.
So this is our API controller over in products controller. And if you recall, if we go and run our application, when we hit our app slash products, that calls this get. Let's do it again just to make sure that everyone remembers. Products. Yep, there we go. There's our file.
Awesome.
Cool. Ah, look, ratings null.
Hey,
that's cool.
Yep.
That's from before.
That's a good sign.
Okay. Now, you're saying we need to go and add to this and make a another call. So we were doing this before with product service was a get, and we could probably do like a post or a put or a patch. But for the purposes of this, let's try a get because I'm just learning.
Okay.
And I don't want to have to install anything.
Fair enough.
So we're going to do a get, and it's going to have some action. It'll result in some action. And we're going to go and get some stuff, and then we were going to call product service, mm-hmm. just like before. Now, product service, we just added this. Product service dot. There you go.
Add rating.
Yep. So this is the add rating from before, and we'll pass in some product ID that we don't have yet, and we'll pass in a rating that we don't have yet. All right. Maybe we'll need to get those. So those should probably be passed into this this get. So I'll say string. Product ID is a string, I think. And rating was a an int, maybe?
Yeah.
Okay.
And so the reason why we're going to use the string instead of like an int for the ID in this case is because I think we want to retrieve it from the link query that.
Well, our IDs in this case are actually what they call natural IDs.
Yeah.
So instead of a number or like a really big, you know, GUID, a globally unique identifier, we're actually using the names of our friends for that as well.
Yeah.
Okay. Now here, it's saying nothing records, nothing is a, not all code paths return a value. When you're doing something, oops, I'm going to go ahead and put that there. I'm going to say return OK. Right? You know how when you hit like a 404, that's a not found? There's a whole series of these. And OK hides HTTP from us. That's a 200 OK, which is
so much nicer.
Yeah, there's like not found and redirect and things like that. Okay. Now, that doesn't really tell us if it's a get or a post or where we're going to get that data from. I know it needs, for what we're doing, we'll say a get. And look, it can be a post or put. And you were telling me about the difference between post and put and get and delete.
Yeah, so lots of different options as you can tell. And in this case, we're using get just so we can test it out.
Yeah.
But the problem with this is since we're modifying part of our JSON at the end of the day here, you could end up with some weird side effects.
Yeah, you don't really want to have a get, which is kind of a harmless thing. Like, hey, I'm going to get that. You don't really expect a database to get updated just because I got some stuff.
Right.
But again, for the purposes of what we're doing, but in the future, we might post, which would like up, you know, make a new thing in the database, or put, which would update the database, or patch, which would be like, I'm just changing a little
portion
part of this. Yeah, so I'll comment that out, and we'll use
that. Sounds kind of useful.
Get. And then right now we're hitting slash products, and we had set that up in this route. We can have a little subroute, and we were going to do rating, so why don't we say route rate. Okay, so this would be slash products slash rate. But then where do these come from? If we were doing a patch, which we were talking about up here, we would go and say, we'll get that from the body of the patch. I'm just going to put that in the comments here. This comment is for some future. But this is not going to come from there. It's going to come from, look,
in
all the other places. It can come from the route, from a form, or from a query string.
Yep. It's a lot.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. And some people like to stack these up. You know, it's totally up to you. Things don't have to be all on one line. That some people like that. Some people want to make it all in one line. It's cool. So we do a get. We're going to grab it from the query string. What do you think the chances are that's going to work on the first try?
well, my
chances
my
are low.
Yeah.
Well, we can give it a try. First thing to do is see if it compiles, and then we'll try to run it. And again, I'm hitting Control F5. And what I'm going to try to do here is I'm going to pull that over to the side and snap it, and then I'm going to do this because I'm confident. What we're going to do is have the data on the left. So this is our database, in air quotes. And then on the right here, let's go and try to say products slash rate. And then again, we're doing this with a get.
Yep.
What did we say? Product ID?
Yep.
ID.
So that syntax we're using, the question mark is like the where.
Actually, that's a good point. Why don't we do this? Let's go into Notepad. And we'll write that URL.
That's a good idea.
So everyone can see it. And then I can copy it over. So cactus and rating equals, I don't know, 5. Jen's great. So that syntax there is what you're talking about, right?
Yeah. So in this case, it's retrieve the ratings where the product ID is equal to, in this case, Jen Looper dash cactus, and find the ratings that have that are equal to 5.
Okay. So we're going to go and put that in there. And I'm going to hit enter. And nothing happened.
Yeah.
But if we go back over here and click, when I clicked, Visual Studio noticed that our JSON file changed, and then it shows up again. Let's try to give Jen a 4. And there's her 4. Now, again, a get is not a place to do this.
No.
But it makes it really easy for us to go and test.
Yeah.
And we can see that we are successfully updating the ratings, and we've picked them up from the query string. And then what we could do is switch that to a patch. These would go to a from body, and then we could go and hook up like a mobile device or something like that and build out our API. You could create gets and posts and puts and patches and deletes and basically make your entire database available via a web API.
That's pretty sweet.
Isn't that cool? Very cool. So let's take a break, and we're going to come back and try something totally different using a technology called Blazor to make our Contoso Crafts application even cooler.
Cool.